Buying your first home is most likely one of, if not the single biggest purchase you'll make in your lifetime. And if you're currently going through the process of procuring your first home or putting the steps in place to buy your first home, then big ups to you. It's a massive achievement. And even though this is such a big achievement, I know that it can be a very stressful time as well. That's why in today's video, I'm going to show you some tips and tricks how you can get the best possible interest rate from the bank to ensure that you get a bond repayment that is manageable and something may save you hundreds of thousands of rand in the long run. So if this sounds like something you're interested in, then please continue watching. Hi guys, welcome back to the channel. My name is Denver, and as I mentioned before, in today's video I'm going to show you how you can get the best possible interest rate from the bank to ensure you get a bond repayment that is manageable but also saving you hundreds of thousands of rand in the long run. This video is going to be packed with some very useful information, so I suggest you stick around, because close to the end I'm going to show you some very real and implementable steps that you can take to ensure that the bond rate you receive from the bank and the repayment is manageable and something that you can afford for, so you don't end up with some surprise along the way. The first thing we should look at is why it's important to get the best possible interest rate from the bank and the lowest possible interest rate from the bank. This might seem very obvious, but a lot of people don't take note of the importance of this and why in fact it is important to get a better interest rate, even if it's only 0.5% or 0.2% of what you've received. The interest rate that you receive from the bank is linked to the prime lending rate, and basically the prime lending rate is just the number that the South African Reserve Bank sets that creditors should be given at, and then banks use that number as a yardstick to give you a personalized interest rate based on a number of factors. For instance, if you get a home loan from the bank which is set at prime plus 2%, that means that because the prime lending rate is currently set at 7%, that means that your interest rate will be set at 9%, because it's 7% at prime plus 2%. Now you get the bond interest rate of prime plus 2%, and that means on a house of 1.5 million, you'll have a bond repayment of around 13,500 rand per month. And if you pay that over 20 years, that means that the interest you would have been paying to the bank over a 20-year period would have amounted to around 1.7 million rand. That's actually more than what the house had cost you in the beginning, and that's pretty crazy. Now let's say you get that same house of 1.5 million, but the bank gives you interest rate set at prime, which means you get the interest rate of 7%. On that house of 1.5 million, your repayments will be around 11,600 rand each and every month. That's nearly 2,000 rand less if you had to get that same loan at prime plus 2%. And 2,000 rand less on a bond repayment each and every month can go a long way, and I'm sure there's a lot you can do with that 2,000 rand. But even more than that, the interest you'd pay to the bank over 20 years at prime will only amount to 1.2 million, which is 500,000 rand that you'll also save in the long run over a 20-year period. So there's quite a bit of money that you can save if you are fighting for a better interest rate. But another reason why it's important to get the best possible interest rate is because the prime lending rate is fluid. That means South African Reserve Bank can change the prime lending rate at any time during your credit term. For instance, if the South African Reserve Bank wants to stimulate the economy and want the country to spend more money, what they'll do is they'll reduce the prime lending rate, which means credit will become cheaper and more people will spend money on buying cars or even buying houses. On the other hand, they'll also decide to increase prime to reduce spending, and if that happens, it means that your bond repayment will go up by whatever prime increases to. Okay, but now to know why it's important to get the best possible interest rate from the bank, let's look at the steps and strategies you can take to ensure the bank gives us the best possible interest rate. And then after that, as promised, I'll show you some manageable and implementable steps that you can take to ensure that you get an affordable bond repayment and something you are prepared for. So first things first, let's imagine you're on the process of looking for a house and you see a house that you fell in love with, you put in an offer and the offer gets accepted, so you go to the bank to get a bond. You fill out the paperwork at your bank and the bank comes back a day or two later offering you a bond, and they say that you're successful and you're now a homeowner. Most people are elated in that stage, and the only thing that matters to them is that their bond was approved, and a lot of them don't even pay attention to the interest rate they are receiving, because what all that matters to them is that they got the bond approved and they're going to be homeowners. So they don't even take note of having to fight over a percentage point or 0.5 percentage point, because in their minds it doesn't make a difference. And banks know this. That's why they will always offer you the highest interest rate at the start, because they know that most people won't fight about it, and the higher interest rate the customer accepts, the more money the bank makes in the long run. So here's what you really need to do. Once you fill out the forms to get a bond from your bank and they've approved the bond, you take that paperwork, you look at the interest rate and you keep that in mind. You then go to all the other banks. For instance, let's just say that you're with FNB and you apply for a bond through FNB and they come back and they say they're offering you an interest rate of prime plus 1%. That means you're getting 8%. You then take a note of that number and then you go to the other banks and you apply for a bond by all of them. For instance, Absa might come back and they offer you a bond of 8.3%. Standard Bank will then look at that same application and they might say, okay, fine, we'll give a bond of 7.6%. And then you might get the offer from Nedbank at 7.5%. You now have four offers from four different banks, all with different interest rates. And this puts you in a much better position to negotiate. Banks are always willing to negotiate because they know that over a 20-year term of bond repayments, there's a lot of money to be made. So now that you know that Nedbank has given you the best offer of 7.5%, you then take that very same offer and you go back to Absa, who offered you 8.3%. So with that offer, you go back to Absa and tell them, thank you for offering me the bond of 8.3%. Nedbank has actually offered me 7.5%. Would you be willing to negotiate? And to be honest, the worst thing they can say is no. Absa might look at that offer and say, listen, there's quite a big difference between 7.5% and 8.3%. So at this moment, we're out and we can't offer you a better rate. You say, thank you very much. And you go on to the next person. The next offer was from Standard Bank, who offered 7.6%. Now, 7.6% is quite close to the 7.5% that Nedbank has offered you. So Standard Bank will be more likely to share it and they might look at it and they'll say, fine, we'll negotiate and we'll actually offer you 7.45%, 0.05% cheaper than what Nedbank has offered. So now that you've got a better offer from Standard Bank, who's beaten Nedbank by 0.05%, you still don't go to your bank. At this point, you go back to Nedbank and you tell them, thank you for your offer, but Standard Bank has actually agreed to reduce their offer because of your offer, and they're offering me 7.45%. 9 out of 10 times Nedbank will come back, or whatever the cheapest bank would be at that point, and say, listen, that's fine, we'll beat their offer, and we'll offer you 7.4%. And now suddenly you've got the best interest of 7.4%. At this point, you can go back to Standard Bank and tell them that Nedbank has reduced further, but I can nearly promise you that Standard Bank will then step back at this point because banks don't like being paid off against each other too much, or at the very least, they'll go ahead and they'll match the offer from Nedbank and they won't reduce any further. But now you got the best offer of 7.4% from two banks. This is where you go to your own bank and you contact them. You tell them, listen, you've given me an interest offer of 8%, but I've also applied for other bonds and Standard Bank has actually given me an offer of 7.4%. I've banked with you for X number of years and I've been a loyal customer and I'd like to continue that journey with you and our banking partnership with you. These banks are telling me that in order to get a bond from them, I will need to move my whole banking profile to them. And trust me, banks are going to tell you to do this. So you tell your bank, listen, I'd rather stay with you guys, but what you need to do is at the very least match their offer or reduce it even further. I can promise you, even though the bank offered you 8% in the beginning, more than likely they will match the offer or even beat it. So now suddenly looking at a bond repayment of 7.3 or 7.35%, or at the very least 7.4%, that's a 0.65% decrease from the initial offer and makes a big difference in the long run. And trust me, this method definitely works. I recently went through the same process where my own bank offered me prime minus 0.05, but Nedbank incidentally came out all guns blazing of me prime minus 0.5%. And I used the very same strategy, and eventually Nedbank was willing to go as low as prime minus 0.65%. I then went back to my bank and I told them, listen, this is what's happening, and at the very least, you should match the offer that Nedbank offers. Okay, but now to the next step of the video. Let's imagine that you are not ready to buy your first home yet, but are looking to make that purchase in the next year or two. So with a year or two before you're going to put in an offer for your first bond, that's where you need to start doing the planning. And the first thing you need to do is to determine what you qualify for or what you can afford. What you need to do is go to your bank's website. I'll just use FNB as an example. You go to your bank's website and you hit calculator. And under calculators, you will choose home loans and then choose affordability. Here you choose your interest rate. Let's say we keep it prime for now. Then you choose the term, 240 months, which is 20 years. And then you type in your monthly income before tax. Let's say you earn 40,000 Rand per month before tax. You then just hit calculate and they will show you that you calculate for a home loan of around 1.5 million on that salary. The bank will obviously take other factors into consideration like your debt obligations or your credit record, but this should be the ball range in which you are able to afford for and what the repayments would be on a 1.5 million house at prime. But now, just because the bank is saying they are willing to borrow you 1.5 million rand doesn't mean that you are able to afford the repayments on a house of 1.5 million. For instance, at a prime interest rate of 7%, the repayments on this bond will be around 12,000 rand. So how do you know if you are able to afford this bond repayments of 12,000 rand? Well, it's easy. You put yourself to the test. Let's say for instance that you are renting a place at the moment and your rent obligations or your rent repayments are 9,000 rand per month. That means you're still 3,000 rand short of your bond repayment of 1.5 million. So what you need to do is to see if you are able to put away this extra 3,000 rand into a savings account for at least 12 to 24 months without touching it. If you are able to put away that money without touching it for a period of 12 to 24 months, it most likely means that you're able to afford a bond repayment of 12%. But even more than that, if you're putting away this money into an interest-bearing account, it means that over the period of 2 years, you have put away over 70,000 rand, and that 70,000 rand can come in handy when you need to pay some lawyer fees or if you just need to get things to upgrade your home. At least you'll have that money available as well. However, on the other hand, if you catch yourself dipping into your savings at any time for any emergency or something that arises, that means that most likely if you are repaying a bond and an emergency arises or something happens, you're not going to have money to pay your bond or because you're going to have to go into credit. So if you're not able to put away that money consistently, it means that that bond repayment might slightly be out of reach and you should look at something cheaper that's more affordable and will work out for you in the long run. And then on the other hand, if you are not renting at the moment and you are currently staying at home and you've got no other rent obligations, then you should be able to put away the full 12,000 rand each every month into a interest-bearing account. But even above that, you should also be able to put away another 2,000 to 3,000 rand for other payments such as your water, your taxes and your electricity, because buying a home comes on a lot of other costs, so you should at least be able to put away 12 to 15,000 rand in that case. So if you're able to do that consistently over a period of 12 to 24 months, putting away that amount of money, then you will most definitely be ready to pay the bond repayments, and above that you've got quite a bit of money already stashed away and ready to start your life. A bond is a very huge commitment, so always be ready to know what you can afford, ensure that you're able to afford the bond repayments, because if not able to afford it, it will feel like strangulation and having to pay that money over a 20-year period might become too much for you. Obviously, as years go on, your financial situation will become better and the bond repayments will become easier. And it may even result in paying off your bond much quicker. So know what you can afford, put in the effort, make sure you're looking after yourself in terms of being able to afford the bond and have some breathing room. And then just as a quick side note, if this video has been helpful or if it had added value, please consider leaving a like to the video and consider subscribing to my channel. It really helps the channel out and it keeps me motivated to create similar content in the future. Once again, thanks so much for watching and I'll see you guys in the next video.